Hello friends, I'm Dr. Swinder Singh from Punjabi University, Chandigarh. I'll be talking about Zila Parishad today. Which is a part of the course on local, state and local governance, machinery and processes. Zila Parishad, as the name suggests, is a district level body. Zila is a district which is known by different names in different languages. We were not having a tradition of Zila Parishads earlier, although we had a tradition of village panchayats, but the concept of Zila Parishad was introduced later, although there were district level bodies during this British period. But those district boards were for rural and urban areas both, and this Zila Parishad is only for rural areas. By rural area we means that if we take the example of any districts, we have to take out the cities out of that, and the remaining area, which is the rural areas, which is not covered by cities, that comprises the jurisdiction of a Zila Parishad. Now this Zila Parishad, as we are talking about now, it came up after the recommendations of Balwant Rai Mehta Committee. This committee, as we know, was established after independence, after the setting up of constitution, rather when the program, community development program, was started, and this program failed, and planners wanted something, some arrangement or some mechanism to make the program successful, this committee was established. And this committee recommended a three-tier Panchayati Raj system. This three-tier Panchayati Raj system means Gram Panchayat at village level, Panchayat Samiti at block level. A block comprises of 7,200 villages, and district level body, Zila Parishad, for whole of the rural district. This, as I pointed out, covers the whole of the districts. It's a larger body, it is the highest body, it is the district level body, and it has got lot of prestige in it. But before the 73rd Amendment Act, which was implemented in mid-90s on the basis of 73rd Amendment Act 1992, this body was operational in only some of the states, not in all the states. Theoretically it was there in all the states, but practically it was not in all the states. Some states prefer to dissolve these bodies, and they never bother to got it reinstated after that. As far as Zila Parishad is concerned, it is composed of elected members, representatives of intermediate tier, that is the Panchayat Samiti, associated members, and there may be some special members added to it. The 73rd Amendment Act made it a constitutional body with a regular term of 5 years. That means since mid-90s we are having Zila Parishads throughout the country, in all of the countries. We have Zila Parishads as the district level body. When Balwant Rai Mehta Committee recommended the setting up of three-tier system, he assigned only limited role to Zila Parishad, but assigned major role to the Panchayat Samiti, the intermediate tier. But in some other states, Zila Parishad or the district level body, whatever name given to it, in different states, it enjoyed more prestige and powers. Before we discuss about its role and functions, we come back to the composition of Zila Parishad. It is composed of directly elected members, as the mandate of the constitution or mandate of the 73rd Amendment Act is there. And this number varies from state to state. It varies from, say, 15 or 20 members to 75 members. In some states, this number is limited to 25 or 30 in northern states. But in southern states, this number is more. It crosses 50 as far as elected members are concerned. Then there are representatives of intermediate tier. In some of the states, all the chairpersons or the presidents of Panchayat Samiti, they automatically become member of Zila Parishad. And this was recommended by Balwant Rai Mehta committee also, in order to maintain an organically linked bodies, to maintain a link between Zila Parishad, Panchayat Samiti and Gram Panchayat. And then there is a third category, that is associated members, MLAs, MPs and even members of Rajya Sabha in some of the states. These members are there as associate members, and they add their experience and prestige to this district level body. And in most of these states, there is a practice of associating these members, although there is an opinion that we should not associate these members because they try to influence the decisions of the council or elected members. But in most of the states, they are associated and their experience is utilized, although it depends upon their wisdom whether to attend the meetings or not to attend the meetings. There is another category also, fourth category also, that is special representation to some other members having some special experience in the area of local governance or in the area of general governance or in the area of justice, and their experience may prove vital to the functioning of Zila Parishad. So in some of the states, they are also associated. Like urban local bodies, there was a system of aldermen, pattern on British system, associating of aldermen, the seniors or experienced members of society. So with these four categories of members, Zila Parishad Council is made, and there is a chairman of Zila Parishad who is generally elected during the first meeting of the council of Zila Parishad. He is indirectly elected, and the term of the Zila Parishad, as I pointed out, is 5 years, and there is a system of reservation on the pattern of other local bodies, reservation for SCST, and even a system of reservation for backward classes if their population increases a particular percentage. Like in Punjab, the act says that if the population of backward classes increases 20%, then one member may be associated or one seat may be reserved for backward classes. The number of elected members also depends upon the density and size of population. Like in many states, a fixed minimum number is there, say 10 or 15 or 20, and after that, for every addition of population of 20,000, one member is added. This is as far as the composition is concerned. As far as the chairperson is concerned, although he is indirectly elected, but politically he becomes very strong. He is the head of the elected district level body, and it is generally said that he may be in conflict with the elected MLAs or MPs, but again it depends upon the upon certain factors like political party, their wisdom, the working of the Zila Parishad, the level of citizenry in that particular area, and the level of other elected Zila Parishad members. The other wing of Zila Parishad is the executive wing, which is generally headed by an executive officer. In some states, like in Punjab, he is known as chief executive officer. Since it is a district level body, at district level, he is given the designation of chief executive officer. So basically, he is to implement the decisions of Zila Parishad, and along with that, he has to act as agent of state government to communicate various policies, various programs or other information or other legislative measures of state government to the Zila Parishad members. He is also to look after the financial affairs, preparation of budget, maintenance of accounts, maintenance of records, implementation of certain Zila Parishad works. He is responsible for all these sort of things. And he is responsible to procure any record or any information if it is required by Zila Parishad or any other, for any other matter, any information or any necessary data if it is required by Zila Parishad, it is his responsibility to provide that, and he is responsible to provide information of various projects to Zila Parishad. Then there is a committee system at Zila Parishad. Generally there are 3 to 5 committees. In Punjab there are 5 committees, General Committee, Social Justice Committee, Finance and Planning Committee, and then there are Economic Enterprise Committee and so on. The nomenclature of these committees varies from state to state. These committees, in fact, like parliamentary committees, they help these bodies to function in an effective manner, because they take up smaller area, smaller category of functions, and they make thorough discussions on that, and they work thoroughly on that particular smaller areas, and then they prepare their report and then they submit their report to the Parishad. So this committee system is very beneficial, although it is generally not given much importance, but for the practical working of any elected body, this committee system is very effective and very useful. Now, as far as the functions of Zila Parishad is concerned, theoretically, again, we have a long list of functions, like developmental functions are there, administrative functions are there, economic functions are there, and some miscellaneous functions are also there. Under developmental function, we again have a list of agriculture related functions, animal husbandry, irrigation. Along with the animal husbandry, we can add fisheries, sericulture. Then we have an area of cooperation, small scale industries, social education, even sports, rural sports, they are also can be added in under the list of developmental functions. Along with developmental functions, there are administrative functions, routine administrative functions, looking after the office of Zila Parishad, maintenance of records, control over the functionaries, and so on. Then there are legislative functions, that is conduct of meetings, passing of resolutions, providing information to the Zila Parishad members if some specific information has been received from state government, and if it is important to for the members to learn about that information, and then to get the resolutions of Zila Parishad implemented. These can all be added into legislative and administrative function. Then there are financial functions related to taxes, fees, fines, economic enterprises and so on, and preparation of budget and implementation of budget. So we have a long list of functions which have been given to which can be categorized and which can be given to Zila Parishads. But in most of the cases, these functions are theoretical. Practically, Zila Parishads are performing the functions depending upon the powers and functions allotted to it. Now again, there is a discussion how much role should be given to Zila Parishads. Again, we come back to the discussion which was started during Balwant Rai Mehta committee implementation period. One view was that district body should be strong, another view that was that the intermediate level, block level body should be strong. But practical experience shows that on the pattern of Maharashtra, Zila Parishad body, the district level body, that has proved more beneficial. So we can say that Zila Parishads as well as Panchayat Samitis, they can both prove beneficial towards the success of Panchayati Raj system, towards the working of Panchayati Raj and towards the development of the area. So, but there are, at the same time, there are some factors which are responsible, that how much functions, how much powers and how much finances have been allotted to a particular body to make it a successful body. Overall, if we look at the success of Zila Parishad, we get a mixed kind of pictures that overall how much role, how much positive roles Zila Parishads have achieved or performed in different areas. Different studies shows different kind of results. Like earlier in Maharashtra, Zila Parishads have performed very good role. Whereas in northern states, Zila Parishads were only in papers. In some states, for a very long period, Zila Parishads were abolished and state governments were not interested to revive this body. It was only after the passage of 73rd Amendment Act that Zila Parishads are, and along with other local bodies, other three tiers of Panchayati Raj, they are being regularly erected and they are working, they are in office. But practically still, if we want to make these bodies successful, we require a real political will. We require tremendous or sufficient financial resources at the disposal of Panchayati Raj bodies. And we require trained manpowers. That is capacity building on the part of village and rural functionaries as well as the officials. We require a good administrative machinery, a trained administrative machinery, but along with this, we require to introduce some parameters of good governance. These parameters such as transparency, accountability, responsiveness, rule of law, and along with these, we require regular monitoring of these bodies. And with this, with all this, we require a faith on the part of bureaucrats, on the part of political leaders, and on the part of public. Only if this faith is there and there is a sufficient support on the part of government to these bodies, only then these local bodies, including Zila Parishad, can prove successful and they can contribute effectively and vitally to this system. Thank you very much.